Okay, so today we are going to see the next gas chromatography, that is a high performance liquid chromatography, and also can be known as a high pressure liquid chromatography, or you can say the HPLC. So as a GC and HPLC, they have almost similar phenomena and principle of working when they do the separation part. So if we see here, we already see several kind of chromatography till now. Paper chromatography, column chromatography, GLC, gas liquid chromatography. This is a kind of evolved version of the gas liquid chromatography. So you can say this is a very evolved and very advanced kind of phenomena that is based on chromatography, but their application mode is way more higher as comparison to other chromatographic principles. So several chromatography which we talked about, like the based on the mode of chromatography, we are having normal phase mode and reverse phase mode. Second, on the base of principle of separation, like what is major principle or phenomena behind the chromatography or separation, that can be the absorption chromatography, ion exchange, partition, and size exclusion. So we didn't get up from the HPLC. We're also going to see the how we can do the separation on the based of size or any molecular size or particular component that can be separated on the basis of their size. So that we are going to see how it will going to separate in the HPLC. Third, we are having here based on elution techniques. So elution techniques, this we are going to see in like our last point of the chromatography. We are going to see isocratic and gradient separation that is slightly based on the centrifugation, like the gradient centrifugation you already studied. This is a quite almost similar phenomena as we seen earlier in centrifugation. Based on the scale of operation, we are having analytical and preparative HPLC. And after that operation, based on the type of analysis, like sometimes we can just get the quantitative analysis, but sometimes we can get both the quantitative and qualitative. So in qualitative analysis, we just got what are the component present in a compound. But in the quantitative analysis, we can get their amount also, like how much quantity of that particular compound is present. Next is here. So this is a principle of liquid chromatography we already studied, like how we can load a sample on a column and on the basis of their partition on of the stationary phase, or you can say the slight affinity or slight phase affinities between the gases, solid and liquid, they can be partitioned out in different component, or you can say, or in different molecular state. So in this basis, this is a major phenomena that is based on behind the liquid chromatography. Now we have to see what can or what type of the liquid chromatography we can study. So if we see the LC mode, there are like five type of the LC mode chromatography. That first is the normal phase chromatography. I already told you what is the basic difference between a normal phase or reverse phase. What happened inside a normal phase, there will be the stationary phase that will be highly polar, or the mobile phase that will be non-polar in a case of normal phase chromatography. But what happened in the case of reverse phase chromatography, the situation will be opposite. Now, whatever the stationary phase we are having here, that will be the non-polar, and the mobile phase which we are going to use, that will be the polar solvent. So in that case, this is simple, like normal phase chromatography and reverse phase chromatography are just opposite to each other. The difference between them, the stationary phase polarity and the mobile phase polarity. Next here, size exclusion chromatography, that is based on the molecular size. So here the separation which we are going to do, that will be based on the size. Ion exchange, as the name suggesting, there will be some charged ions. On the base of the positivity and negativity, we are going to separate them out. affinity chromatography. This is the highest affinity between the particle and the stationary phase. So the one which are having the highest affinity will be separated first, and which one they have a very low affinity, they will be separated to the least, or you can say sometimes they just pass the column without get even attached. So this kind of mode actually explaining us that how can or what kind of the chromatography we can use in our LC mode. Now we can see on the basis of these chromatography, we are having the packing material, mobile phase and their interaction, like on what kind of principle you can say even. So what on the basis of what interaction they are going to. Silica gel will be using as a packaging material, or you can say the stationary phase. So why we are using it as a stationary phase in a normal, because they are highly polar. And that's why we can use them in a normal phase chromatography. And mobile phase will be in hexane or IPE, that can be used as a mobile phase. And what will be their major principle for the separation? That will be adsorption. So based on their polarity, they will be going to be separated on the basis of their adsorption to the stationary phase. Reverse phase chromatography, that is packaging material, will be silica, carbon-18, that make it slight non-polar. So that's why in that case, we will be calling them the reverse. So in here, the mobile phase, that can be used as a methanol and water. So you can see they are non-polar solvents and slightly non-polar as compared to the silica C18. There will be the hydrophobic situation. Hydrophobic is the opposite to the water-loving situation. So that's why the separation will be based on the content which is not going to be absorbed on the stationary phase. Size exclusion, easily that can be this oxyanion that can be used here, THF that is called oxyanion, that can be used as a mobile phase here, and porous polymer. Actually, using the porous polymer is based on, like, they are having some very small kind of pore inside this polymer that will be present as a stationary phase. So we got the result on stationary phase inside the chromatography. So here, when we are going to pass something on the stationary phase, the on the basis of their size, they are going to be excluded here. Like the very small particle, they are going to be fit inside this porous polymer, but if some compound, or you can say if some component of that compound having a large size, they will be going to pass the column. So on the basis of coming out from the column, on the basis of their size, like the most large kind of molecule will be passed first, because gravity also apply and their masses will be more, so they will be going to pass very earlier. And the small size and very small size will be going to be, very small size just going to be absorbed in this polymer, and small size will be going after the large size. So on that case, we will be studying the size exclusion chromatography as a separate topic. Ion exchange chromatography, that is solely based on the positive and negative ions. Like if we are having a compound or sample which is positively charged, so we are going to use a stationary phase as a negative, and if we are having a negatively charged component or sample to be separated, then we are going to use a stationary phase as a positive. So simply, you know that opposite attracts, so that's why they can be easily opposite in the case of stationary and mobile phase. Affinity chromatography, same. They also having some specific ligands there. And mobile phase will be using as some buffer solution. So whenever they are going to pass from that, they on the basis of their affinity, they will be going to separate out. So these are the common type of LCs, or you can say these or technique: normal, reverse, size exclusion, ion exchange, affinity. They are all going to come under the HPLC, or you can say in anyhow evolved version, they are a part of the HPLC technique. Now we are going to see what is HPLC. So HPLC is a high performance liquid chromatography as the full form. It can be also known as high pressure liquid chromatography, because there is a very specific feature of having a high pressure pump which is going to use under the HPLC. So based on that high pressure, which actually exert on the mobile condition to pass on through the column, so that's why we can also call them the high pressure liquid chromatography, high priced liquid chromatography, because this is very costly. So that's why we can call them the high priced liquid chromatography. It is a column chromatography, so actually we are going to use column here, so that's why we can call them a column chromatography. We are going to use mobile phase as a liquid phase, so that's why we are calling them a liquid chromatography. So every name which we give into the HPLC, either it is high pressure or high priced, column, liquid, these are all our basis of their working process, like how they are going to work. On the basis of that, we can call them liquid, column chromatography, very costly, high pressure will be going to exert it. So all these conditions are mandatory to performing the HPLC. It is modified form of the gas chromatography. So if we compare them, so there will be a modified version of the gas chromatography. And also it is applicable for both volatile as well as non-volatile component. We already seen that in the gas chromatography, I mentioned you that the only thing which can be volatile that can be separated inside the gas chromatography. But here, that's why we need a chromatography which can also do separation of the non-volatile compounds. Because we just don't have to separate the volatile things. We also need the separate to the non-volatile component. So that's why we need a technique, we need a thing or chromatography which will going to separate the non-volatile compound. So on that need, we emerged with this technique HPLC. And you can say this is a answer for mostly all the compound analysis you can be done by having the HPLC. It can mainly divide into two types. So major distribution or classification of HPLC we see that will be normal phase and reverse phase. We already discussed what is normal phase and what is reverse phase. It is having a high resolution and separation capacity. So if we talk about the resolution and separation capacity, so this is, if we compare other chromatography which we already studied, this is the best one till we got. It is used as qualitative as well as quantitative analysis. So both the kind of analysis, qualitative and quantitative, you can do by this only, this HPLC. This high performance liquid chromatography is a chromatographic technique used to separate a mixture of compound in analytical chemistry, also in biochemistry, with the purpose of, what is the major purpose of HPLC is here. Why we are using it inside analytical chemistry, biochemistry, biotechnology. The major purpose was to identifying something. If we have an unknown compound and we wanted to know what is inside it. So on that scenario, they can work on the identification, qualifying, purifying the individual component of the mixture. So all these three major things can be done by having the HPLC. Identifying, quantifying and purifying. You can quantify something, you can know what is the quantity of a particular component in a mixture, or you can also purify something, like if a component of a compound or a mixture having some impurity, you can separate them out. This is how the HPLC look like. This is a major machine. So you can see this is not a very simple kind of chromatography like we used in column, TLC, paper. They are like very having a very short kind of instrument to work on. But this is the one which is going to involve several processes inside it and several detectors. They will be having like 4 to 5 even detectors. Till now, the things which we are having, we just can use one kind of detector. But inside a single instrument of HPLC, we are going to see several kind of detectors, high proton pumping, not proton pumping, high pump of a mobile phase, or separate. Sometime it can be work on the duplex column and the valves. There will be a lot of valves which are going to regulate the pressure of mobile phase inside the column. Now the principle, if we talk about now what is the principle or on what principle HPLC is working. So the two things which is a major part inside the HPLC, one is the adsorption and the second one is a partition chromatography. So they will be doing two things, adsorption and partition. Partition, this we got from the gas chromatography. Adsorption, this we also seen inside the paper chromatography, TLC also. So they do the functions on the adsorption, but in HPLC they are working on the two principle here, combinedly adsorption and partition. It's depending on the nature of the stationary phase, and that can also be, sometimes it can also just work on a single principle, but that solely depend on the what kind of stationary phase we are using. So if stationary phase is solid, principle is based on adsorption chromatography, and if stationary phase is liquid, then we are going to see the partition chromatography. So the simple that in the GS also, GLC also, we see that the stationary phase will be like liquid, so the thing which we are going to use is the partition. And if we are going to use solid principle like we did in the TLC or we did in the paper chromatography, then the principle will be the adsorption. So it is important for determination of volatile and non-volatile components. So both the things we can isolate here, not to just, they are not grouped only for the one kind of component analysis. We can determine both the kind of compounds, like the volatile and also the non-volatile. So it is important for determination of qualitative and quantitative analysis. So just not only the qualitative one, but also you can do the qualitative analysis and quantitative. Means you can identify what is in it and how much amount of that particular component inside the compound. You can also isolate that too. So it is important for determination of retention time. So you know the retention time. I think till now you are understand the basic terminology of the chromatography. Like the retention time, the time is required after the sample injection, maximum angle peak reaches to the detector. So you can simply learn it as a definition of the retention time, the thing or time required for identifying some component from inside the mixture. So inside a component, inside a compound, if you got a component at a certain time, that is their retention time, and retention time is also very specific. It cannot be similar for other kind of component. Every component have their own and unique retention time. And this is the important fact that we can do the separation inside the chromatography. The major, you can say the major role is of the retention time, which is going to give us separate molecule on the separate time period. These are the also a diagram of HPLC. Now we see the advantages, how what kind of advantages we can get from having the HPLC here. It is simple, rapid and reproducible. Okay, so it's not quite simple actually. The thing, if we going to monitor it for the beginners, it will be complicated. But yes, if you are having very advanced kind of version of HPLC and you have a mastered over the chromatography, and this will be simple for you. So this is simple in that case only, but it is rapid. They give the very rapid decisions actually. The reproducible means we can generate anything from it. High sensitivity, sensitivity in nature is very high. You can even separate a very tiny molecule from it. Not the separation is not just the basis of the larger molecules, even a very small, sometimes very partially charged or sometimes very slightly polar thing can also be identified. High performance, so that's why their performance rate is very high in each and every aspect. Rapid process, hence time saving, so process is very, you know, rapid, or you can say the taking with so many, so less time, so that's why it can be time saving. It is having a high resolution and separation capacity. So they have, because of having this high resolution, their separation capacity is high. Accuracy and precision. So they will be accurate. The result which we are going to get from HPLC, there is a 99.9% of chances to be accurate. There is never accuracy rate is called 100% in the science. So we always call the accuracy rate if something is very efficient, very accurate, giving everything whatever they need up to the date, So we can call them the 99.9% of accuracy. The stationary phase was chemically inert. So the stationary phase that we are going to use, that will be chemically inert, not going to reactor. So wide variety of stationary phase can be used. Mobile phase was chemically inert, same. So because why we are using this term here, the chemically inert. So meaning of the using this word chemically inert means they are not going to react with the sample which we are using here for the separation. Because if the sample will be reactive, or sample, or you can say mobile phase and stationary phase will be reactive with the sample, they can lead to destruction. Less requirement of mobile phase in developing chamber. So we don't need much more pre-preparation for mobile phase inside the delivering inside the developing chamber. Early recovery of separated components. So we can do very easily separated component, whatever the separation will be done on a very primitive stage, we can got it very first. Easy visualization of separated component. You can see each and every component separated from that particular compound. It is having good reproducibility and repeatability. So reproducible nature and repeatable nature means you can do back-to-back sample analysis. Sometimes the machines, they cannot perform on the reproducible, repeatable mode. This HPLC can do that. They do not have any time bond or something which they are going to need in an intermediate phase. It is analytical technique. It's important for validation of product, quality control, studies of product. So as it is analytical technique, giving us the numeric form also, numbers and validation proof. So that's why we can use them inside the quality control or product quality. If we make something new, or sometime the product which we are thinking is not up to mark, so we can analyze it by the HPLC. Simply, we can analyze the component which has been used inside that compound or suspension. It is important for qualitative and quantitative analysis. We know that it is used for both analytical and preparative purposes. So both the you can say there are many more goals which we can be obtained by having the HPLC. Now the type of HPLC separation, normal phase, we got it. Like the separation of polar applet by partition onto a polar bonded stationary phase, reverse phase, and that we are having this stationary phase with the non-polar. Adsorption in between the normal and reverse, separation of moderately polar analytes using adsorption onto a pure stationary phase. So actually this going to use something solid here, and our non-polar on the base, or you can say the mobile phase is totally non-polar, but the sample which we are using here to be separated, that have some polarity or no polarity in between them. So basically on the adsorption, if we inside the normal and reverse phase in between them, we can get the sample on the basis, mostly on the basis of their polarity. Ion chromatography, here we are going to have the separation on the base of the ionic stationary phase. Size exclusion, I already explained you how the molecules got to be separated when having a small and larger size. The small size, they will be inserted inside the gel, and if they are having the large size, they will be passed through the column. Now there are some methods which can be used for the several specific compound analysis or separation. Like this, these are the models actually. This HPLC, every time a company make a HPLC, they just name them. Like SDW05 23000 WPP WPP5 SHW6. So these are, you can say these are the models. Like every vehicle have a model, so the same here, every instrument also have their models, and on the basis of their model we can analyze their efficiency. So here the efficiency or the methods which they explained here, on the basis of their compound analysis, like what kind of compounds we can analyze by having several different methods, like benzene wake, spats wake, acrylic, explosive, benzodiazepines, phenoxy acids. So every other kind of component need a different kind of HPLC model. Sometimes they are like, if the condition is very specific or they want a very specific kind of separation, then we can do a slight alteration inside the HPLC and make them for the analyzation for the compound, or the, you can say, specific kind of compounds. You can see here modes of high performance HPLC, like type of compound they give here: naturals, weak acids, weak bases, ionic bases, acids or soluble or not inside the water, ionic or inorganic substance. So actually they are telling here in this table that what kind of compound will going to use what kind of mode and stationary phase and mobile phase. So in this, this is a like important kind of HPLC monitoring system. Like if you know that what kind of compound can be analyzed in what mode of the HPLC. Like if we wanted to separate out the naturals, naturals means which do not have any kind of charges, neither they are acidic nor they are basic. So we call them the neutrals. Weak acids and weak bases. So this mode that is, we can call by which we are going to separate them, that will be the reverse phase. And here we can use the carbon 18, 8 for kinones and the aminos. And mobile phase which we are going to use here, that can be the water and some organic modifiers. If we wanted to separate the compound like ionized or bases or acids, the higher ones, they will be going to use the mode of ion pairs. So ion pairs which are going to make them basically on the basis of their ionization. So C18, carbon 18 and carbon 8. And there we are going to use same as a mobile phase, water, organic ion pair reagents. So that can be an addition here. Some ion pair reagents which are going to help these particular compound to bind on the stationary phase. Compound not soluble in water, that can be like normal phase chromatography will be used. So here silica, amino, cyanose, diol, we can use any kind of stationary phase, and mobile phase can be organic. Ionic, inorganic ions, in that if they are highly ionized ones, we are going to use ion exchange here. And anions or cation exchange resins, we can use it here. Or mobile phase can be aqueous and the buffer counter. High molecular weight compound polymers. So in that case, we are going to, like if we are talking about a molecular weight compound, so we needed a something which can be do the separation on the basis of their size. So here we are going to use the size explosions. In that case, we are going to use stationary phase as a polystyrene silica, and mobile phase like the gel filtration aqueous or permeation organic gel. Permeation organic is a kind of very efficient kind of mobile phase which you can use in a size explosion chromatography. Now the HPLC contains in a stationary phase, you can say normally, which can be, it is non-polar, and the stationary phase solid surface is coated with the second liquid. The stationary phase is immiscible with the mobile phase. So these are certain compounds which can be used as a mobile and stationary phase here. So this is a block diagram of HPLC, like what are the things we are going to need for having a HPLC. Or you can see these are the components of a HPLC. Like we are going to use reservoir, pump, gradient controller, mixing chamber, reservoir here for the pump, solvent conditioning, fractions, injector, P column, analytical column, then detector, fraction collector, and then recorder. So these are the steps which are going to come under the HPLC. So why HPLC? We already see like the advantages of HPLC: simultaneous analysis of qualitative and quantitative, high resolution, high sensitivity, good repeatability, moderate and analysis condition, easy to fractionate and purify, and not destructible. So these are the major goals, or you can say these are the major points which make us to use HPLC over other kind of chromatography. Now, the instrumentation of HPLC, what are the things we are going to need here? Like the solvent storage bottle, that is the first thing which is storing our mobile phase. After that, we are having gradient controller and mixing unit. So in this, we are having this thing which is going to mix our proper concentrate. Degassing of solvent, here we just, you know, compressed out any kind of gaseous form inside the solvent. Pumps which pump the, or you can say exert pressure on the solvent to pass it from the stationary phase. Pressure gauge, so they are just controlling the pressure. Pre-column, that is before it enters to the column, everything will be monitored inside the pre-column. Sample introducing system, that is the part in which we introduce sample in it. Column, detector, recorder, so these will be the part. Column, detector, recorder, you already know in the PLC also, we see why we are going to use it. But there are some certain different situations inside the HPLC if we compare them to the normal GLC. This is a kind of, whole diagrammatic representation of HPLC working. But I think this will be like, you can see it here. This is a regulated helium source, so you can see the gaseous chambers, which is going to exert the pressure here. So in this whole unit, the thing that is, the monitored here, that is the pump or the managing of pump, that will be exerted primitively, the step which is going to take place inside the HPLC, that will be going to start from here. And after that, this solvent pumping valve, that will going to lead to pass on the solvent from here. Pump, they are checking the all the pressure or exerting the pressure on the solvent, which has to be passed through after that the filter and the column. So this output check valve means how much amount of the solvent will flowing through this valve is important. This is a pulse damper. Pulse damper actually work for mobilizing the particular solvent on that particular pressure which has been exerted that by that this pump. Inlet check valve. So this, when the solvent has coming inside the pump, this is the inlet check valve which checking out the flow of the solvent and converting them to the output check valve. To waste, if something is waste, then it will be going out. The only thing or only pure sample which has to be analyzed there, that can only go through the filters. Filters also here for checking out anything which can be disturb the working of the column, that should be straight out. Again, that's why we call them the dual prospectors inside the filter, because they monitor each and every step for removing any kind of impurities. Back pressure regulator and pressure transducer. So basically, if this is for the controlling the pressure of the mobile phase here. Injector valve. So here we are going to inject our sample, and after this flow and injection of our sample, they will be going to pass on the column. This is a final stage almost inside the HPLC, in which they are going to separate them out on the basis of adsorption and partition that depend on the what kind of stationary phase we used here, and finalize for the detector and recorder. You can see here some simplest form of that previous diagram, like the solvent here, and you are going to pass it from a pump which is going to maintain their flow. In medium phase, flow of the mobile phase, we are going to inject our sample here, and after that they will be going pass through the column, and column is going to separate the particle on the basis of separation and adsorption. After that, the results which they are going to get at the end of the column will be passing through the detectors. Then detectors will be going to make the chromatogram on the computer data station. And anything which is like the some kind of waste product, that will be going to exert out from this detector. They never send the recording, or you can say they never send a data that has to be create some unmobilized things here. So that's why anything which known can be as impurity or known can be as a waste product, that will be exerted out even sometime from the this in this method only by between the pump and the HPLC column, major columns. There are several, you can say there are several walls or the step which uniformly working on the exerting out the impurities from the sample. But it's still the somehow the last thing which we got inside the detector, and detector also feel like that there are something which can be as a waste product, they will be going to emit that out. So now after the final thing which we got from HPLC, we are going to see on the computer screen as a chromatograph on the basis of their retention time. Retention time is very important inside the chromatography. So whenever you studied a HPLC or any data, the most important thing in a detection and studying analysis of that particular component is the retention time. Because on the basis of retention time only, you can analyze a particular separated molecule from a compound. This is also the same thing. So these are the major particles like reservoir, data science detector, pumps, injector, column, things which are required for a HPLC. Now the solvent reservoir actually the thing which we studied in the very first primitive phase. So these are some conditions which are required for preparing a reservoir. Like the glass or the stainless steel container, they are capable of holding up the 1 liter mobile phase, pure organic solvent or aqueous solution of salt and buffer. So anything like this organic solvent or any kind of mobile phase which we are going to use for sample separation, they are will be able to hold that. Glass and stainless steel, they are very hard thing, so actually they can store these kind of thing. Inert to a variety of aqueous and non-aqueous mobile phase, they are inert because they are not going to react here. Stainless steel should be avoided for use with solvent containing halide ions. Yes, that's the point, that like if we are going to separate something based on halide ion, then in that case they can be reacted with the stainless steel. So in that case scenario, we are going to use the glasses. And most of the things we can use glasses, and also like 60-70% of all the components can be analyzed by a stainless steel reservoir. But sometimes some of the, because it is somehow the form of metal, so that's why in any case sometime it can be reactive, but most probably stainless steel is a non-reactive metal. Pump, you know what is the major work of pump? The thing you can see here that they can be exert the pressure up to like 6000 pascal or 414 bar. So this is a pascal, this is a pressure measurement that can be pumped out by the pump. And you can also say that as the particle size of stationary phase is smaller, like the 5 to 10 micro, the resistance of the flow of solvent will be higher. So jitna bhi chote se chota size hoga, then the resistance jitna bhi uska hoga wo kaisa hoga, high hoga, aur flow jo hoga wo zyada hoga solvent. So this is smaller the particle size of stationary phase is a greater resistance of the flow of solvent. So that basically inversely proportional to each other. Septum injector, we are going to in an injector sample stop flow. Sometimes they have to stop the flow if something is not appropriate inside the injector. So the stop flow, basically a valve which we open while, you can say which can be opened just after injecting the sample, and unless you didn't inject the sample, this will be the in a stop mode. Hydride injector, so this kind of injector we can use, and in this we can inject the sample like 20 microliter or 50 microliter. So this is their capacity to introduce this kind of sample inside the HPLC column. So there are three valves also. So if we are working on HPLC, we have to know these three kind of valves: selection valve, load position, and inject position. So actually they are telling us the actual monitoring sites inside the HPLC, like what condition they are appropriating. For selection valve is kind of analytical purposes. Load position, in this sample is loaded or sample is in the loop position. Inject position, that is injected then it will be open, and if it not injected there will be at the stopping phase. column, pre-column and analytical column. So pre-column, actually this whole thing why we introduce a pre-column here is based on the all proportionate working of the column should be efficient. So anything which has to be analyzed, analysis work before the final separation. Analysis of sample that has to be done inside the pre-column, like the size, sample type, any impurity, means every check level that can be done in the pre-column. And after that, when we send it to the analytical column, and it everything has to be accurate for the separation. So analytical column we can use like the stainless steel or the sometimes that can be the glass one. And the size that can be 225 to 100 centimeter, or diameter that can be like 2 to 4.6 micrometers. So these the dimensions of a particular column which we are using inside the HPLC. Detectors, there are like several kind of detectors which are going to detect the separation inside there. They can be, if we are talking about the absorbance, UV, VIS and PDAs, refractive index, photoability, fluorescence, if anything is fluorescent we use, electrochemical, like some electrodes are using an ion exchange, then detectors will be electrochemicals, or conductivity for ions that can be used for ionic charges, light scattering that can be used, mass spectrometry, and basically HPLC and MS technique. We use the MS, otherwise MS will not be refereded here, because MS is a purely is quantitative technique. So we don't suggest much in a sole HPLC to use the MS technique. Ideal detector properties, like what kind of important property that has to be present inside the detector. Like they should be very highly sensitive, universally or predictable specificity, large linear response range, low dead volume, non-destructive, insensitive to temperature and mobile phase, continuous operation, reliable and easy to use, no single detector fit all these criteria. That's very obvious, because not everything can we have every property. So that's why we have to use like 4 to 6 kind of detectors inside the HPLC. So based on the sample, we just choose one kind of detector at a specific time to detect particular separation. Okay, recorders, and this will be going to be much. Last thing, the application. This year, what kind of application we can do by having the HPLC, like drug discovery. We can analyze specific kind of drugs. Clinical analysis, proteomics, protein study, forensic chemistry, forensic science, drug metabolism study, any drug, how they are going to react inside the body can be analyzed. Environmental chemistry, something new in environment can be analyzed. Diagnostic studies, anything which you wanted to diagnose what is present inside any compound. Cosmetic analysis, determination of green fluorescent proteins. If we use some fluorescence to study the protein, we can also isolate them here. Structural determination, if we wanted to see any structure. Pharmaceutical application, in pharma, when we make a drug and if we wanted to see how their component analysis working on a particular formula, then we can analyze that too. Clinical application actually based on this pharma application. Biochemical genetics, if we manipulate some kind of genetics of a species, then also what are the major protein conformation based on those genetics, we can isolate that too. Qualitative quantitative analysis, that simple. Therapeutic drug monitoring means what are the major influence of that particular drug in each and every stage of a cell cycle, then we can analyze that too. So there are several kind of application which we can go through with having the HPLC here. These are some references you can go through if you have further queries.